Due to votes on the House floor, the hearing will start at approximately 2:25.
This hearing of the Terrorism, Nonproliferation, and Trade Subcommittee will come to order. And let me just say, today's hearing is going to focus on an issue, China's Indigenous Innovation, Trade, and Investment Policies, an issue that myself and Brad Sherman have worked on in the past. China's economy has been rapidly growing, and this has meant opportunities for American businesses, but it's also meant perils. And Mr. Sherman and I have worked to bring attention to the fact that many U.S. business people are getting fleeced in China, their property stolen, and much worse. We heard from Nancy Weinstein previously in a hearing of Long Beach, California, who went through a nightmare in Shanghai. And we've heard from many other business people about their similar experiences. The State Department even reports that Americans may be held hostage in China over commercial disputes. Today, we consider China's Indigenous Innovation Policies. The Chinese government has been turning up the pressure on U.S. and other foreign businesses to share sensitive technology with Chinese state-owned enterprises as the cost of selling in the Chinese market. This is done through an ever-changing web of government policies, official policies, as it pertains to procurement, regulation policies, tax policies, and those governmental policies also encourage U.S. companies to move research dollars and jobs to China. China is looking to move its economy from made in China to designed in China, and they're playing hardball to do it. A top administration official has described the threat. China's indigenous innovation policies threaten global intellectual property protections, fair government procurement policies, market competition, and innovators' freedom to decide how and when they transfer technology. This presents some U.S. companies with the dilemma of agreeing to these terms and making sales, though at the risk of their long-term competitiveness, because Chinese companies potentially will then take their technology and become their competitors. These commercial concerns are intensified by rampant Chinese government industrial spying in the U.S. There are obvious national security concerns, too. This issue goes to the heart of a company's competitiveness and our country's economic well-being, and I'm not convinced that these policies are an economic winner for China in the long term either, but I know they'll hurt U.S. businesses. While traditionally preferring quiet diplomacy, U.S. businesses are increasingly vocal. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce recently released a report, China's Drive for Indigenous Innovation, sounding the alarm. We'll hear from the U.S. International Trade Commission today, which has produced a detailed report on this problem. And this comes against a backdrop of broader concerns over China's trade and investment policies, including very poor intellectual property protections, which harms U.S. firms. In January, Chinese President Hu Jintao and President Obama signed a joint statement pledging to de-link indigenous innovation from China's very large government procurement market. On paper, this was a win for the U.S. China also committed to join the WTO's government procurement agreement this year, which would help curb its indigenous innovation policies. But China has a history of promises made, promises broken. We should aggressively challenge these policies. They worsen our trade deficit with China. What we don't want to do is blow up the system in a way that sets back U.S. exports, which are critical to economic recovery. Currently, U.S. exports to China are rapidly growing. China is emerging as a serious economic challenger. It's building national champion companies, as they call them in China, to compete globally. The Commercial Aircraft Corporation, for example, has Boeing in its sights. And this challenge is coming. Indigenous innovation or not. And this means two things. One, pressing China, and two, better competitiveness. Our country needs to approach economic competitiveness also with urgency. And this means tax and regulatory and budget reform and a slew of other issues beyond this hearing's scope. I will now turn to the ranking member, the gentleman from California, Mr. Brad Sherman, for his statement.
Mr. Chairman, I thank you for your statement, and those who think that this city is divided by partisanship will find that that's not true when it comes to the to you and me and the issues that we face at this hearing today.
We flip gavels again, but continue these hearings. Thank you.
In the year 2000, the United States made an enormous blunder in granting permanent most favored nation status to China in a bill that was H.R. 4444. Ironically, that number denotes extreme bad luck in the Chinese tradition. Of course, the bad luck has all been ours. The U.S.-China trade deficit swelled from $83 billion, already outrageous in the year 2000, to a record high of $273 billion in 2010. It grew every year except the recession year of 2009. The Economic Policy Institute estimates that roughly 2.4 million American jobs were lost as a result of our intentional blindness to this trade deficit. We hear from supporters of the current trade policies that the volume of exports to China has never been higher. This is true. We hear that the rate of growth in exports to China is now greater than the growth of imports from China. True, but misleading. Misleading in part because what we're exporting to China is scrap iron and scrap paper so that they can ship us more exports. But what's more telling is that the trade deficit with China continues to grow as increases in imports from China outpace increases in exports year in, year out in absolute terms. The industrial base and quality of U.S. employment continue to erode. China conducts a number of unfair trade practices that keep American exports out and, more importantly, aims to set aims at setting up export promotion policies that the American public should not tolerate. And American firms have been all too happy to oblige in order to take advantage of cheap labor, various incentives, and whatever they can do to up their particular corporation's quarterly report. As the chairman noted, if you do business in China, good luck. You'll have to enter into a joint venture, transfer your technology, and if you're lucky, you may be allowed to flee China rather than being held as hostage. At the urging of our current chairman, back when our roles were reversed, we held a hearing in July 2008 on the topic of U.S. business operating abroad. That hearing detailed the horrible experiences of Americans, especially American small business, doing business in China. I want to commend the chairman for today focusing on an aspect of the China trade policy that has shaken even the most slavishly pro-China corporate interests. And those interests are so outraged that they have demanded that we take what they count as tough action, namely a strongly worded letter. In 2006, the Chinese government announced a strategy for promoting what it reportedly translates as indigenous innovation. China no longer wants to make iPads. They want to develop the next iPad. They no longer want to license technology from the West. They want to develop it there, or at least steal it and claim ownership of it. Among the policies that have been floated since that time to implement this dream is a restrictive government procurement policy. Overall, China's effort is to increase its trade deficit with the United States, not to decrease it. Promulgated in November 2009, this draft policy provided for the creation of a product catalog that would list goods in several categories approved for purchase by Chinese government agencies. Such goods would have to be developed in China and the intellectual property held by a Chinese firm. These draft regulations were softened somewhat in April 2010, but are still considered to be objectionable by the U.S. business community. During his recent visit to Washington, President Hu committed to de-link procurement from indigenous innovation. Whatever that means, and it probably means almost nothing, what is important in the Chinese system is that the central government has, through its actions to date, already informed bureaucrats, provincial officials, and managers of state-owned enterprises that they need to buy Chinese products and Chinese intellectual property whenever possible. You can't unring the bell. The word has already gone out. And whatever the final regulations provide, if you are a bureaucrat or provincial official in China and you buy products containing American intellectual property instead of Chinese intellectual property, you are subject to re-education, regardless of what the official regulations finally state. Nominally, the policy is not already on the books, but the word is already out. We can't complain about anything because there's nothing official in their published final regulations. This is how China beats us at the so-called free trade process. We operate only by written standards. They get the message out orally or through unofficial documents. And then we deliberately ignore the fact that that gives them a way to restrict American exports that we do not have. The procurement policies were complemented by anti-monopoly patent technical standards and other policies that discriminate against foreign products and or force technology transfers as a condition of doing business in China. If anything gets the attention of the business community, it should be this. Another aspect of China's innovation policies to develop 16 so-called mega projects. Chinese managers seek to co-innovate technologies borrowed from the West to develop passenger aircraft and chip and circuit manufacturing equipment, et cetera. And I think the chairman outlined this well. What happens to American firms that are helping China develop these industries after China can make the products on their own? It was Lenin who said, "The capitalists will be happy to sell the rope."
I think my time
has more than expired. I thank the chairman for his indulgence, and I'll use some of my question time to go over some of these points. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We're joined today by Jeff Duncan of South Carolina. We have with us Bill Johnson of Ohio has an opening statement. Go ahead, please. We'll try to keep these opening statements to 1 minute each if we can.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank our panel for being here today to discuss an issue that has attracted growing concern in recent years, particularly for American businesses that have worked hard to become innovators in high-tech industries. Whether it's through currency manipulation, massive government subsidies to Chinese industry, or newer concerns surrounding indigenous innovation efforts, the threat China poses to American exports is of growing concern. U.S. businesses have taken great risks to develop new technologies and innovate like never before. Because of American leadership in technology, protecting U.S. intellectual property is more important than ever, especially when it comes to our biggest trade rivals. We must have safeguards in place to ensure our continued position as a global leader in the high-tech sectors of the world economy. American businesses are faced with tough decisions these days. Our economy is showing some positive signs of recovery, but many business owners are still struggling to discern what is best for their development. China's aggressive indigenous innovation policies are the cause of one more tough decision. Abide by China's terms and risk long-term competitiveness as Chinese companies steal American technology, or lose access to the enormous, fast-growing Chinese market and put American exports and jobs on the line. The American people have always expressed a strong desire to achieve and move our nation forward, sometimes taking risks in order to do so. We must protect the investments that American businesses have made in innovation as other nations attempt to imitate our ingenuity and surpass us. And we can't allow our willingness to be open to the benefits of trade defeat the gains that we've made. As we move forward and evaluate China's trade policies, we must keep this cautious optimism at the forefront of our global trade strategy. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson. Ms. Schwartz, I think yours is the last opening statement.
Actually, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Connolly, go ahead, please.
I thank the chairman.
Jerry Connolly of Virginia.
And just real briefly, Mr. Chairman, I have a full record I would ask be entered into the record without objection.
Without objection.
And obviously, I represent a very high-tech district, but I think the whole battle of Chinese policy with respect to innovation, Chinese requirements with respect to the transfer of technology and knowledge, the lack of protection of intellectual property, are real issues for businesses doing, to say nothing of repatriation of profits and capital, or even making a profit, as Mr. Sherman indicated. So I'm very interested in Ms. Laney's point of view about this and her insights into it. But I think that moving forward, part of the problem with doing business in China is it cannot be just one way. And the United States government has an obligation at some point to protect the interest of U.S. companies doing business in such a broad and large market. I thank the chair.
Thank you. Let's go. Mr. Rohrabacher, I think you had a statement. Before I mention that, Anne Marie Burkle serves as vice chairman of this committee, and we're delighted to be working with her and to welcome Renee Elmers as well as a member of the committee. Mr. Rohrabacher, go ahead with your opening statement.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for holding this hearing, and I appreciate Mr. Royce and Mr. Sherman and the great work that they've been doing on this for a number of years. Let's just note that there's been a massive transfer of wealth from the American people to China. This has happened as a result of policy decisions made not by the Chinese, but by the people who run the United States government. This is working against the interest of the people of the United States. At first, it was thought to build up their economy would create a more democratic society. Mr. Chairman, instead of a democratic society in China, we now see emerging a threat to the peace of the world, a dictatorship, the world's worst human rights abuser. It's time to take a look at those policies that have permitted this transfer of wealth and the transfer of technology and investment from the United States into China at the expense of the people of this country. Our people have been betrayed by a lack of action on the part of our own government to watch out for them rather than some globalist perspective. So I'm very pleased to be here today, and I'm going to be listening to the witnesses, and hopefully we can alert the American people to the changes that need to be made to protect our country.
Thank you, Mr. Rohrabacher. Before I go to Allison Schwartz, another new member from Pennsylvania of this committee, for her statement, let me just take a moment, and we have a distinguished visitor with us, Ben Gilman, who has served as chairman of the International Relations Committee. Ben, if you would just stand for a minute here to be recognized. Thank you. Thank you for all of your service, Ben. It's good to see you. Ms. Schwartz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to say, as this is my first meeting in the subcommittee, I'm pleased to be serve on the committee and on this subcommittee. And as we begin this hearing, I just want to say, as I've heard from some of the large companies that do work, have facilities both here, of course, and even some still have headquarters here, have been seeking to do business in China. They have often, I think to this point, said we're fine, it's a huge market, but are now calling on us to do even more to make sure that their intellectual property is protected, that some of the not well articulated but well understood requirements that the Chinese put on them to put plants to share their intellectual property, which then shared is a nice word, I think, really is doing us great harm for the future. And so we've got to figure this out. So I look forward to the testimony and to this hearing to figure out how we can both have our companies take advantage of the huge marketplace that China is, but to do it in a way that protects their ability to grow not just there, but here, and grow internationally, and also to have some discussion about what effect it is having on employment and job growth here in the United States. Obviously, we've seen some progress. We do want to, I believe, operate in a global marketplace, but we need to do so in a way that is fair to our businesses and fair to our workers. So I look forward to the comments and understanding that you'll share with us, our witnesses will share with us today, so that we can take the kind of action, again, that will grow our economy, understanding what a huge market China is and how unfair some of their policies are to both to our businesses and to our own growth here. And I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Schwartz. We'll now go to Ms. Karen Laney, who is the Acting Director of Operations for the United States International Trade Commission. She previously served as the Director of the Office of Technology Policy over at the Commerce Department. She's also served as Deputy Director of U.S. Steel Trade Policy at the U.S. Trade Representative's Office during WTO negotiations, and she holds an MS degree in Resource Economics from the Colorado School of Mines. Now, I should note that the ITC is an independent U.S. government agency that supports policymakers through fact-finding investigations and research. It does not make policy recommendations. The Senate Finance Committee directed the Commission to prepare two reports on intellectual property infringement and indigenous innovation policies in China. Director Laney will present information from the first completed report. She cannot address the second ongoing report. So, Ms. Laney, thank you for presenting your key reports, findings here, the key findings to this subcommittee. And afterwards, if you'll keep this brief to within 5 minutes, maybe summarize it, we'll go right to questions.
Very good. Thank you, Chairman Royce and members of the subcommittee for this opportunity to testify before you today. As the chairman noted, my remarks will be summarizing the more extensive written submission from the commission's first report. Those written remarks are entered into the record. The first report was delivered in November of last year, and our second report will be given to the Senate Committee on Finance May 2nd. Today, I'll be describing what indigenous innovation policies are, how they are being employed in China, and why they are of concern to U.S. firms. First, let me say there is a wide understanding about what indigenous innovation policies actually are. In the Commission's first report, we broadly considered these policies as the collection of Chinese policies that are aimed at increasing domestic innovation and, where possible, replacing foreign intellectual property with domestic intellectual property in goods that are produced in China. The policies are intended to advance China's innovation goals that were articulated in the 2006 national plan called the Medium to Long-Term Plan for the Development of Science and Technology. I'll be referring to that as the MLP. The broad goals in the MLP are for China to become an innovation-oriented society, a global leader in science and technology. The policies that are reflected in the MLP are broadly focused on high-tech industries of national interest in which innovation plays a key competitive role. These sectors include agriculture, energy, environment, manufacturing, national defense, some frontier technologies such as biotechnology, advanced materials, lasers, ocean technology, and as Mr. Sherman indicated, certain large-scale mega projects such as core electronic components, large aircraft, water pollution control, and treatment technologies. In our report, the Commission identified several areas in which indigenous innovation policies are being drafted or applied, but today I'm just going to touch briefly on two of those. The first is technical standards. Excuse me. China's technical standards strategy recognizes the importance of technical standards as drivers of technology, innovation, and trade. The MLP has highlighted the importance of incorporating Chinese intellectual property into technical standards. And in China, there is a top-down approach to standards. The central government ministries decide what standards will be developed and lead the process. This is in contrast to the United States, which has a much more decentralized process led by private sector. Reportedly, the Chinese system for development of standards tends to be non-transparent and to exclude meaningful opportunities for foreign companies to provide input and comment. According to U.S. firms, Chinese standard-setting bodies frequently take an existing standard, change the technology requirements slightly, just enough to add significant costs and make it much more difficult for foreign manufacturers to sell their products in China. This restriction of market access is one way that Chinese developed technical standards reportedly affect U.S. companies. A second is that they reduce royalty payments to U.S. firms. More examples and more explanation of this are in my written comments today. So I will move on to talk just briefly about government procurement policies. During the Commission's research, government procurement policies promoting indigenous innovation were one of the areas of greatest concern for U.S. firms. The annual market for Chinese government procurement is estimated to be between $88 billion and $200 billion annually. I want to note, as the members here have already said, that the government procurement policies were a focus of discussion during the December meeting of the U.S.-China Joint Commission on Commerce and Trade, which occurred after the release of the Commission's first report. Our second report does include information and analysis about subsequent events since November of 2010. Of particular industry concern during our first investigation were the draft national government procurement policies that were issued in April of 2010. These applied to six high-tech sectors, and as indicated, they contain certain provisions that must be met in order for any product to be included in a national procurement catalog. Another requirement was that approved products must be free from any type of intellectual property dispute, which was not defined in the draft regulation. U.S. firms expressed concern that an unsubstantiated allegation raised by a third party, perhaps a competitor, could be used as a reason to exclude a foreign-made product from the government procurement catalog. One important point which has been made, but let me stress this, although no national procurement catalog has been released, there are a number of provincial procurement catalogs which are actively in use for government procurement decisions at the local level. Most of these catalogs include very few products that are made by foreign companies or by joint ventures. This situation underscores the fact that the Chinese government ministries and agencies at all levels are working to implement the central ideas of the MLP through a wide variety of policies under separate jurisdictions. This variation makes it extremely difficult to track the development and implementation of such policies. Although relatively new and still evolving, indigenous innovation policies have the potential to pose significant problems for U.S. companies trading with or operating in China. It is clear from the NLP that China is intent on raising the level of scientific and technological innovation that originates within the country. Policies appear to be promoting indigenous innovation and sales of domestically made high-tech products at the expense of foreign firms. U.S. firms note that China's approach to innovation policy seems to vary significantly from global business practices. For example, requirements that R&D take place exclusively in China are broadly incompatible with the global innovation policies of many multinational companies. In sum, some U.S. industry representatives believe that indigenous innovation policies pose a greater potential threat to their business in China than do either intellectual property infringement or currency-related issues. They described, as Mr. Sherman indicated, a web of interrelated policies that work together to help build national champions, which are Chinese industries capable of competing with foreign companies both inside China and in third country markets. This concludes my testimony this afternoon, summarizing some of the findings from the Commission's first report. I would say that the Commission's second report will provide more specific analysis of the scope and impact of China's indigenous innovation policies. It updates information about U.S. firms' concerns, provides several case studies, and presents the results that were obtained through mailing out 5,000 questionnaires to U.S. companies asking for their experiences and insights regarding indigenous innovation in China. After public release of the report in May, we would be pleased to come back and brief the committee on those findings as well. Thank you.
Ms. Laney, let me ask you just a couple of quick questions here. First of all, China has not signed the WTO's government procurement agreement, right? So that means that U.S. and other foreign firms that try to do business there can be discriminated against by China in government contracting. What I'm wondering is if you have a sense of the scope of that, if you could give us some examples. And I think it's important because we have a number of us here that have called for Congress to act to preclude Chinese companies from bidding on U.S. government contracts until China makes this decision to join and sign this agreement and keep to the agreement so that we've got a two-way street here.
During the JCCT in December, the Chinese did make a commitment to apply for admittance to the WTO government procurement agreement, of course, by the end of this year, 2011. I'd be happy to provide, to get back to you with some examples.
Well, you know, I'll get the examples from you later.
Yes.
But in the meantime, do you know the extent of current Chinese contracting at the state, local, and federal level here in the United States?
No.
With our U.S. government?
No, and I will look into that and get back to you on that.
Yeah, I think that would be very important for us to know and certainly for us to know as soon as possible.
Okay.
Let me ask you another question. You testify that foreign businesses have reportedly been pressured to transfer know-how and technology to Chinese firms in order to gain access to the Chinese market, something that we hear about from businesses out in California all the time. But maybe you could give us some examples of specific U.S. businesses and how this plays out so that we can understand precisely and maybe so that the other members here and the audience can understand precisely how this is done.
Most of the information that we have had concerning specific impacts of tech transfer policies are going to be reported in our second report.
Do you have any examples right now that you'd like to share with us? Because I would imagine that someone in your position, I'm familiar with a half dozen, so I imagine you have access to some of this data.
Well, certainly we have heard about situations and have heard from industry, such as the semiconductor industry, which has talked often and publicly about their concerns with different technical standards, for example, the WAPI standard that the Chinese employ rather than the Wi-Fi standard that we use here in the United States, and pressure to adopt those technical standards in order to be able to do business or sell products in China. Of course, semiconductors are in many different types of products, so that has a ripple effect. Also, the same industry has talked a lot about preferential tax policies, which are given to high-tech Chinese industries rather than for foreign industries. So there are examples like this. In addition, the wind energy, wind has talked about to us about some of the discriminatory regulations that are in place, requiring experience, requiring certain proof of business practices in order to be able to access the Chinese market. So we do have some specific examples in various high-tech industries about these concerns.
And in fact, these violate current treaties with China, do they not?
I don't know.
Well, I'm going to allow Mr. Sherman here to ask his questions. I thank you again for appearing as witness.
Thank you. just to take a minute before I begin asking questions, I, for one, have lost patience with China and our trade policies toward China. We need balanced trade with China. The only way to achieve this is for Congress to revoke most favored nation status for China and to direct the administration to enter into emergency negotiations, knowing that MFN will end by the end of the year, to arrange a new system, one that results in balanced trade and one that perhaps follows Warren Buffett's approach, which is a voucher system where you, in order to import anything from China, need a voucher from someone who has exported to China. I know all of my colleagues here are a bit frustrated with China. The question is, are we actually going to do something, or are we just going to send more strongly worded letters? Now, let me ask the witness. The ITC, back in the year 2000, predicted that granting most favored nation status to China and letting them into the WTO would be associated with roughly a $1 billion per year increase in our trade deficit with China. Turned out that over the last 10 years, you've been off by a little less than $2 trillion. Wouldn't that make you just a little bit shy about issuing any kind of projection for the effect of the proposed Korea Free Trade Agreement?
I would have to take a look at the basis upon which that prediction of $1 billion was made and compare that to what we're doing for our Korea analysis.
Most organizations, when they make a $2 trillion error, go back and look at that even without having to be prodded by a bald congressman from California. But I'm happy to play that role. Now, picking up on the Chinese, the comments about China made by the chairman, our natural approach when China does something, and by issuing this directive, unofficial as it may be, to all of their government-owned enterprises and provincial officials, they've already taken action to keep American intellectual property out of their procurement market. Our natural thing is to send a letter and then do nothing, because that's what the most moneyed interests in our country would suggest that we do. What we could do instead is introduce and adopt legislation prohibiting state, local, and federal governments from procuring anything from China until such time as they sign the WTO agreement on procurement and are certified by our president to be in compliance. Would such legislation be in violation of WTO?
I'm not prepared to comment on that.
Will you respond for the record?
I will take that question back to my agency, yes.
So you may just refuse to answer?
No, sir, I just don't know the answer.
I know, but you'll go back to your agency and then respond for the record, or are you committing to get me an answer?
Yes, sir, I am.
Okay, okay.
I am.
Now, looking at the Korea Free Trade Agreement, you have made an estimate that it would reduce our trade deficit slightly. Now, the agreement allows for products such as automobiles, automobile parts, ships, electronics, iron and steel to be 65% made in China and then only 35% made in South Korea. And then the work done in South Korea can be done by Chinese guest workers in barracks. Does your estimate as the effect that the Korea Free Trade Agreement will have on U.S. balance of payments reflect those two factors? That is to say, the 65% made in China, 35% made in Korea, access that this gives the Chinese, and does it reflect the fact that South Korean firms can use grossly underpaid Chinese guest workers for products shipped to the United States? Are either of these in your estimate on the Korea Free Trade Agreement?
The employment, the guest workers calculation is not. The rules of origin related to the percentage of parts that are sourced from various places is captured in a larger factor in our model analysis that looks at non-tariff measures?
I don't think you're off by a couple trillion dollars per decade, but you're off. Because this Korea Free Trade Agreement gives open access to the U.S. market to goods produced by Chinese labor, 65% in China, 35% guest worker in South Korea. And I hope you would revise your estimates. And not only does it give Chinese labor free access to U.S. markets, it does so without China making a single concession to the United States, and they get a free trade agreement in effect, and the resulting trade imbalance will be attributed to the South Koreans rather than the Chinese. There is nothing more beautiful about a trade agreement for China than the you couldn't have a more beautiful agreement for China than the U.S.-South Korea Free Trade Agreement. I yield back.
Mr. Duncan from South Carolina, but before we go to you for questioning, we've been joined by Mr. Poe from Texas. We appreciate his attendance. Go ahead, Mr. Duncan, with your questioning.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Ms. Laney, thank you for being here today. I had the opportunity after reading the Friedman book, The World is Flat, back in 2005, to travel to China. So I've been to southern China in the Guangzhou area and then up to Beijing, and really thought it was a fascinating experience for me as a legislator in the state at the time and bring those experiences to Congress. But I wanted to bring up the issue this afternoon of production of rare earth minerals. And we use rare earths in many new energy technologies and high security, national high-tech national security applications. And I'm concerned that while the U.S. was once self-reliant in domestically produced rare earth elements, over the past 15 years, we've become 100% reliant on imports primarily from China, which controls more than 95% of the world's rare earth supplies. The Wall Street Journal published an article on March the 6th stating that China has begun building its stockpile, which further increases the Chinese government's power to influence the minerals prices. As we discuss the possible threats of China's indigenous innovation, trade, and investment policies, I would like your thoughts regarding China's monopoly of rare earth elements and how that would affect U.S. technology. Ms. Laney, is the U.S. vulnerable to supply disruptions of rare earth elements? What effect would a disruption have on our military's ability to produce important defense applications like jet fighter engines, missile guidance systems, anti-missile defense, space-based satellites, communication systems, the technology things just go on and on? So if you'll answer that.
The United States is vulnerable at this time because we have no operating capacity in the United States. However, we do have access to some types of rare earth minerals. And so the effect of supply disruption would depend on how rapidly we could reopen and get up running, in part.
Yeah, we're seeing China continually try to buy these in places like Saharan Africa and Africa and South America and other places. What should the U.S. do about that, if anything?
I'm not prepared to offer a suggestion regarding policy. Sorry.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
We'll go to Mr. Cicilline from Rhode Island.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this important and very timely hearing, and welcome, Ms. Lane. My state, home state is Rhode Island, and we have been especially hard hit in this recession. In fact, it was the first New England state to go into the recession, and currently we have the fifth highest unemployment in the country. And particularly in the area of manufacturing, where Rhode Island was really the birthplace of the American Industrial Revolution and home to a very important and robust manufacturing sector that's been very hard hit in this recession. The Alliance for American Manufacturing concluded that there were 71,000 manufacturing jobs in Rhode Island in 2000. By 2008, that number had dropped to 47,900. And 15% of the manufacturing jobs lost in Rhode Island during that period were lost due to trade with China. And so with regard to this, the indigenous innovation policies that we're talking about today, I'd like to first note that I know many of the indigenous innovation policies are in different stages of development and haven't all been adopted yet. And of course, this practice really relates only to one area where the Chinese are undertaking a really conscious effort, I believe, to discriminate against U.S. exports and illegally promote their own exports. And I have tremendous concerns in light of the history of what we see in Rhode Island, and frankly, in states all across our country, about what we are doing and what we can do about this. And so my question really is, what kinds of retaliatory mechanisms do we have at our disposal to respond to this? And other than filing dispute resolutions with the WTO, are there other things that we can do that can effectively respond to this? As Mr. Sherman said, this is a growing and serious problem that I think many members of this committee over many years have become increasingly frustrated with.
Right. I would say that in our research, one of the things that we heard over and over again was companies asking that the government continue to talk to China. That may not sound like it's sufficiently bold, but as Ms. Schwartz pointed out, a number of companies have concerns about being able to continue to operate in China and expressed their interest in continuing to have a dialogue with China as opposed to punitive measures. This was the kind of information and suggestions that came to us as we did our research. Now, with the questionnaire that we put out for our second study, we did ask for suggestions from companies. We asked them to give us information on what the economic impact has been to them, the employment impact. So there will be some concrete numbers and perhaps some more specific suggestions coming from the companies that we surveyed.
You know, I understand, and I think suggesting that conversations would be ongoing makes sense, but at the same time, I think people expect that there be some vigorous enforcement. And, you know, we're arguing, I think, very hard for maintaining our investments in education and infrastructure and innovation, because I think we all recognize that America, you know, is the home to ingenuity and innovation, and we can compete in the world economy and succeed. But if at the end of that process, after we make that investment, we don't have a fighting chance because there is, you know, the kinds of violations that are present with respect to China, then we have no real opportunity to continue to grow our economy and succeed. And so I understand that conversations and negotiations continue, but I think many of us are looking for, and I know the manufacturers that I speak to back in my district are looking for enforcement and looking for protection of their intellectual property and compliance with the requirements with China with respect to trade. So I hope we will do that as vigorously as we talk and send letters. Thank you. I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you. We're going to go to Mr. Bill Johnson of Ohio. Before we do, let me just explain to the members that the International Trade Commission is a government agency. And as part of their charter, they don't make policy recommendations. That's panel two. So Ms. Laney probably be in a little bit of hot water back home if she tried to roll out policy recommendations for us here. I just wanted to explain that. We'll be into all of that in the next panel. Go ahead, Mr. Johnson, with your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Laney, you stated in your written testimony that the U.S. International Trade Commission performed two investigations on intellectual property infringement and indigenous innovation policies in China. In addition, you also mentioned the 21st U.S.-China Joint Commission on Commerce and Trade, the meeting this past December, which also focused on indigenous innovation. While I realize that the conclusions of the second investigation have not yet been released, let me ask you this. What similarities can be drawn between these recent inquiries into China's indigenous innovation policies? More specifically, how serious an effect do these policies have on American businesses that interact with China when compared to other trade practices such as currency manipulation and subsidies provided by the Chinese government?
The companies that we interviewed for our first investigation and those that attended the hearing, the two-day hearing that the commission held, by and large indicated that they were more concerned about the Indigenous innovation policies going forward than they were about currency manipulation. They would say that subsidies are probably a part of that whole web of Indigenous innovation policies. Because these policies are relatively new, most of what we heard was concern going forward. The government procurement draft that came out in April, I think, sounded a real alarm for a lot of companies that China was moving more aggressively to favor their domestic industries, their high-tech industries. So in terms of what is of greatest concern to U.S. companies, that varies somewhat between sectors, but they're looking forward towards this web of policies. Some of them describe it almost as whack-a-mole. You fix one policy, something else pops up. But in terms of currency manipulation versus Indigenous innovation, what we were hearing is that high-tech companies are more concerned with the Indigenous innovation web.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
We'll go now to Anne Marie Burkle from New York, who's the vice chair of this committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ms. Haney, for being here today. My question has to do with the Indigenous innovation policies, how you would characterize those. If we had to look at it, I just would like your opinion on this, is it more of an extortion towards American businesses, or is it something where the American businesses just realize the risks and they realize the gamble that they have to take and they think that it's worth it?
I would say that in our experience during our investigation, the answer to that question depends a little bit on the experience and even on the size of the company doing business in China. Companies who have been in the Chinese market for a while report a different experience and have a different characterization of the regulations than do smaller firms or firms that are brand new to the market. So those companies that have been in the market for a while, I, by and large, would probably not characterize it as extortion. It's a cost of doing business and one that they find discriminatory. But that is not a view that's necessarily held by brand new small entrants to the market.
I guess if you could clarify that for me, what, just because they've been in it longer, what is the reason why their view is so different than the newer?
It would be speculation on my part to say why that is. When I'm talking about the size of a company, often large firms have more resources in order to understand what the legal system is, in order to deal with multiple government officials, those kinds of things. So there are resource issues that go to how a company interacts and experiences the business environment in China.
Thank you. I yield back.
Mm-hmm. If you could, Ms. Laney, if you could pull your microphone closer.
Yes.
We'll go now to Ms. Elmers from North Carolina.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ms. Laney, for being here today with us. I'd like to go back to the currency manipulation issue that you discussed a moment ago from Mr. Johnson's question. Basically, considering the undervalued Chinese currency, you know, 40% undervalue, and that's, I know that's estimation. It basically serves the government in their strategy for export, strong export market from China. And it affects us, of course, in our country, affecting our jobs and whatnot. What strategy should the United States government be taking with this? Because I hear this continuously back home. This is of great concern to North Carolinians. And, you know, what input can you give us on that?
I'm sorry to say that I'm unable to provide you with anything today, with any recommendations concerning currency manipulation. It's really outside the scope of the Indigenous Innovation report that I'm here to summarize for you.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Ms. Laney, one idea I had was maybe you could just describe a couple of the options to us out there instead of making a set recommendation. If you don't feel comfortable with that, that's okay, but it's an idea.
That would be if you could give us just an idea of some of the approaches that you have been taking, something that we can base some information on, something that we can look forward to.
The commission isn't involved in setting policy mm-hmm. or in negotiating. So what we're doing here is we're reporting the suggestions of companies that we've interviewed, which, mm-hmm. as I indicated, most of them have been saying to us, we would like for you to keep talking. We would like to have WTO mm-hmm. handle this. We appreciate the fact that this is coming under scrutiny. In fact, several of the industry officials with whom we've spoke point to the fact that increased scrutiny was one of the factors, in their opinion, that led to the concessions at the JCCT in December. And they advocate that government, the executive branch, Congress, continue to shine a light on this, and that the Chinese are willing to change. And again, whether it's whack-a-mole or it's substantive long-term change can be debated, but the Chinese are willing to move on this when a spotlight is shined on this problem. This is what we're hearing from businesses, yes. Okay. Yep.
Thank you very much. I yield back.
Thank you. Jerry, did you have any questions? Mr. Connolly, go ahead, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'll try to be brief. I'll ask two. One is, Ms. Laney, the American Chamber of Commerce in China, 31% of the 300 members cited discriminatory government policies and inconsistent legal treatment as being the largest single barrier to doing business in or with China. What's being done to try to make sure that, A, we have a consistent commercial legal code in China and that it is consistently enforced?
I would defer to USTR on that one. I know that there are a number of cases that have been brought to the WTO concerning violations to our international agreements, our international trade agreements. There are also various government programs which work on the legal aspects of trade and of business in China, is my understanding. I can look into that more for you if you would like.
Be helpful, thank
okay.
you. What about, in the same category, the laws and the enforcement regarding intellectual property? How consistent are those laws with under WTO rubric, international standards, and how consistent is the enforcement of those laws?
The enforcement is very inconsistent of the laws. It varies between the national level and different provincial and local levels. It is not transparent in many cases. There is a slightly different patent system in China, which does not afford the same strong protection as some of our intellectual property mechanisms. Much of this is detailed in the report that we provided to the Senate Finance Committee, and I'd be happy to send you a summary of that.
Be very helpful, thank you. Mr. Sure. Chairman, I know you want to move on, so I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Connolly. We'll go now to Judge Poe from Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It seems to me that China operates under two systems, legalized theft and just old-fashioned theft. You can do business in my country of China if you show us how to make your product, and then on the sly, we'll copy it and we'll sell it ourselves. That's sort of their legalized theft system. And then the traditional, just old-fashioned stealing is they pirate all kinds of things. Movies is a prime example. Software, whether it's the government or whether it's private industry or industry in China, seems to be that is their trade policy. I agree with the ranking member, Mr. Chairman, or Mr. Sherman, that we ought to look at the most favored nation status that we bequeathed on China and review that very closely, especially in light of the fact that We now import these CFLs from China that have mercury in them, and pretty soon that'll be the only place on earth where we get them. We don't make them in the United States. We've gotten lead paint from China during the Christmas season of 2009 that had toys, had lead paint and toys. They sent us dog food that had poison in them. The drywall has been constructed throughout the United States that now turns out to have smelly sulfur gases, and the drywall falls down during a hot summer Texas heat. And now the FDA has taken Chinese toothpaste off the market because it's got life-threatening chemicals in it. So I'm not so sure we get a good deal on what we get from them. It concerns me, all of these matters, and my question to you, I mean, I believe in free trade, but also believe in free and fair trade. If, I'm not asking policy, I'm asking you a result. If we take away China's most favored nation status, how would that affect United States companies?
I'd like to think about that and get back to you on that one, if I may.
Well, I'll hold you to it, too.
Okay.
And the second question, how will that affect U.S. economy if we take away their most favored nation status?
Okay.
That's two questions. Now, I would want to expect an answer sent to the chairman and the ranking member. Do you have a statistic?
If the gentleman would yield.
Oh, certainly.
My bill is designed to create an immediate crisis, 6 months to negotiate a whole new trade process with China rather than just end all U.S.-Chinese trade.
Reclaiming my time, how much money does the United States lose every year because China cheats? Do you know?
No, sir.
Can you find that out for me? Do you know what I mean by cheat?
No, sir.
It's their legalized theft and their sort of old-fashioned stealing. Can you quantify that for me?
I'll tell you. In our second report, we do give some estimates based on the questionnaires that we've received, the questionnaire responses, where companies have given us some estimates of what they believe their losses have been due to intellectual property infringement. And so, certainly, when that report is made public in May, I'll see that you get those figures that are based on U.S. company estimates, and if there are further questions, we can follow up with you on those.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Laney, the Harvard Business Review of December 2010 has an article on this, China versus the world. They go through a lot of pages to say what Mr. Poe said very succinctly, but they lay out the argument for the cheating that he discussed, both in terms of what they do by way of espionage and copyright infringement, as well as what was previously referred to, I think, by one of our members here as extortion. But it will be laid out in economic terms in that piece for you, and we would like a report on that. And I think we now go to Mr. Rohrabacher from California.
I thought I would, by the way, I'd like a copy of that report in May as well. If you could send that in my direction, that'd be very interesting. Mr. Chairman, an Orange County company run by someone you know and who I know ran a dry cleaner cart manufacturing company. It had 150 employees about 15 years ago. And it had been in business for 75 years. And they made the carts that you do for dry, you go to a dry cleaner and a laundromat, and you'd have these carts there. Well, about 5 years ago, it came to my attention that a group of Chinese businessmen had come to Orange County and purchased two of these dry cleaner and laundry carts. And a year later, the container arrived at the port of Long Beach filled with exact replicas of the dry cleaner and laundry cart that this man's business had been, and their family had been in business for 75 years, with about 150 employees. And it was such a copy that on the outside of the box had been copied, and they had a check mark, red, black, or white, for the different colored carts, although the Chinese manufacturer only made one color, which was black. The Chinese then went to my friend and said, by the way, we can just keep doing this and drive you out of business, or why don't we become partners? Why don't you hire us to do your manufacturing? I think it's called extortion, and he agreed to this. And you know what happened then? After a few years, guess what happened? There's not the 150 workers anymore, and he's being edged out of the company. And now it's all a Chinese company. So you have, for 75 years, an American company setting up a group of people in China to now make the laundry and the dry cleaning carts that used to be made by Americans. If we put up with this, shame on us. Not shame on the Chinese. They're avaricious. They're out to make a buck. They're watching out for their own people. Who's watching out for the people of the United States of America? Now, my question to you is, who would that dry cleaner complain to? Who in the government can help him so that over a five-year period he doesn't lose everything to an overseas group of people who are coming in and copying his product? Who in the government is it that he should go to? Who's not doing their job, or at least who can we direct him to?
If I would say that this is a legal issue which he needs to pursue.
Mm-hmm. So who's that? You mean like hire a private lawyer and sue them? There's nobody in the United States government that's responsible when entities from overseas, especially in China, come in and basically commit extortion and take and pressure you into giving up what your family has built for 75 years. It's just there's nothing in our government that does this.
I'm not aware of anything in the trade community, which is.
My theory is that there are things that there are entities in the Chinese government that are there to help the thieves. But we don't have the entities here to help our people to protect themselves against organized foreign theft, especially that coming from China. By the way, the Chinese are not just stealing things like this. We are the victims of cyber attacks, and everybody knows this. This is not something that has gone on without the Chinese government's knowledge. They are aware that there are business people who are coming from their country into our country and committing these types of acts of extortion. They are aware that there are hackers coming into our system, stealing all the information they can get their hands on. Mr. Chairman, we've got to get tough, or those people overseas who are tough are going to run us over and steamroll our people. And that's what's been going on. And shame on us if we don't have the strength and courage to stand up to that kind of challenge. Thank you very much.
Well, let me make, reclaiming the rest of Mr. Rohrabacher's time, let me just make an observation. From political scientists to economists to philosophers, one of the great achievements of this republic was in its constitution. This is the conclusion. The history of the United States, that one of the great achievements here was that we had in our very Constitution laid out a protection for intellectual property, copyright. And I guess what's baffling is the fact that this was so obvious to the founders of this republic, the importance of this principle of protecting intellectual property. And I guess what is so obvious to us now is how cavalierly this has been treated, both overseas and obviously by the United States, that we have turned a blind eye to a fundamental concept to protect human capital, to protect intellectual property, which is frankly the engine of our prosperity. So if we don't have a ready answer to what to do about it, then I think we'd better return to first principles. And we understand that your role is you cannot give us policy recommendations, but I think it is the role of us as members, and we'll hear shortly from the second panel who will give us those recommendations. But I think this highlights how important this is. And as for legal action, having gone through this with many of my constituents who have taken cases to court in China, I know just how futile that is, just how ridiculous it is to expect that to ever bear fruit, to see our own government hesitate in terms of getting involved in what they call the Chinese legal system, when that legal system, frankly, from what I've seen of it, is not based on legality. It's not based on the rule of law. So we face a very real challenge here that must be addressed now. And with that said, I think you had a unanimous consent request.
Yes, unanimous consent to insert in the record the report commissioned by the AFL-CIO titled Manufacturing Insecurity, America's Manufacturing Crisis, and the Erosion of the Defense Industrial Base.
Very good. And I want to thank our witness. We have quite a few follow-up questions for the record, and we look forward to that information. Ms. Laney, thank you.
Thank you. Yes. May I say one other thing?
Yes.
To Mr. Rohrabacher's question about the dry cleaning cart.
Right.
My colleague from the commission reminded me that we do at the commission have what we call 337 proceedings, yeah, which are intellectual property. They're a legal way for U.S. companies to challenge the theft of their intellectual property when products are imported and a U.S. company thinks that their IP has been infringed. They can come to the commission and file a legal proceeding there.
337, you call
Yes,
it?
Sir. Section 337.
Okay.
But it's called.
Very good. All right. We will go now to our second panel. Thanks, Ms. Laney. For our second panel, we're going to hear from Mr. Peter Brooks. He's a senior fellow for National Security Affairs at the Heritage Foundation. He also serves as a commissioner with the Congressional U.S.-China Economic and Security Review Commission. And prior to coming to the Heritage Foundation, he served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Asian and Pacific Affairs. He also served with the Central Intelligence Agency and was on active duty with the U.S. Navy. Mr. Philip Levy is our second panelist. He's been a resident scholar in economics at the American Enterprise Institute since 2006. He also is an adjunct professor at Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs. In 2005, he joined the State Department as a member of the Secretary's policy planning staff. He was responsible for international economic issues, which encompassed developing the responsible stakeholder policy toward China. So we'll hear that how that's working out. And then lastly, we have Ms. Thea Lee, Deputy Chief of Staff at the AFL-CIO. Previously, she worked as an international trade economist at the Economic Policy Institute in Washington and as an editor at Dollars and Cents magazine in Boston. Ms. Lee serves on several advisory committees, including the State Department Advisory Committee on International Economic Policy and the Export-Import Bank Advisory Committee. She's also on the boards of directors of the Workers' Rights Consortium and the National Bureau of Economic Research. So I believe all of you have appeared before this subcommittee before. I'd ask you to summarize your testimony and keep it within 5 minutes, if you would. We start with Mr. Peter Brooks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I also served as a staff member on this committee many years ago under Ben Gilman. It was great to see him today.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here to discuss China's policy of indigenous innovation in my role as a foreign affairs specialist and observer of and participant in U.S.-China relations for some 15 years now. The views I express today in my testimony are my own and should not be construed as representing any official position of the Heritage Foundation or any other organization with which I am associated. I will summarize my testimony that has been submitted for the record. There's no question that China today poses a significant set of challenges for the United States and the international community. While its regional and global aspirations appear to be quite extensive, it has been reticent in publicly stating its grand ambitions. Nevertheless, we can observe a number of behaviors on the part of the Chinese that indicate that Beijing expects to see itself at or near the top of the international pecking order at some point in the not-too-distant future. As a result, we are faced with a number of current and potential problems posed by the Chinese that arise from their seeming ambitions to be a major power politically, militarily, and economically. China's role in international economics and trade is a concern, especially issues revolving around export-driven economy, trade imbalances, market access for foreign firms, state subsidies, its WTO obligations, and the convertibility and value of its currency. These issues are all well known to committee members. Today, the question is on China's controversial policy of indigenous innovation. While there are differing definitions of this policy, generally it might be considered the giving of preferential treatment to locally developed technology and government, Chinese government procurement, which runs at about $105 billion annually. To be considered locally developed, the Chinese government must certify that the technology involved in the product in question was developed or advanced in China. In return, foreign firms are allowed to do business in the potentially vast China market. But as many would agree, the indigenous innovation policy is a Chinese effort to gain access to foreign intellectual property, which will in turn improve China's commercial competitiveness at home and abroad. Via this policy and other means, China intends to propel China into the company of the world's most technologically advanced countries, including the United States. China's indigenous innovation policy is, in my view, an unfair practice that disadvantages the foreign firms that are subjected to it. It inhibits market access for foreign firms. It is also a threat to our economic competitiveness globally. And if it remains in force or is expanded, it may allow China to move from its place as a major global manufacturer to a high-technology innovator. That, of course, is China's goal. Finally, while there are U.S. policies and measures in place, we must also be wary of how any technology transfer, foreign or domestic, might affect our national security in light of China's military modernization, which is a growing concern. The bottom line, while indigenous innovation is one way for China to gain access to desirable foreign technology, the fact is that protecting high-technology intellectual property in China has been, is, and will be a significant challenge for foreign firms. Beijing is bent on China becoming an advanced technology economy as quickly as possible. As such, we should not expect the multi-vectored Chinese threat to American technology, which is not limited to the indigenous innovation policy, to abate anytime soon. The question, of course, is what can be done. First, and quickly, it is my belief that firms could choose not to do business in the Chinese market. This is, of course, a private sector corporate decision that the government should not interfere with. U.S. firms should be aware of the threats to their intellectual property while doing business in China. Second, it should be a priority for the U.S. government to get the Chinese government or any other government to walk back policies and make technology transfer a condition for access to its market. Third, when appropriate and an available remedy, the United States, in concert with others, if possible, should bring Chinese trade practices and policies before the World Trade Organization for remediation. Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to present my views on this vexing matter that faces foreign firms, especially those of the United States doing business in China. I'm happy to take your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks. We'll now go to Dr. Levy.
Thank you, Madam Vice Chairman, Ranking Member Sherman, members of the committee. I appreciate the opportunity to testify today on the challenges posed by China's indigenous innovation policies. With your permission, I'd like to offer a brief summary of my testimony and submit the extended version for the record. China's approach to intellectual property and government procurement is and should be a real source of concern for the United States. It may well prove costly to American firms, but there are limits to how costly these policies can be. Indigenous innovation policies are unlikely to achieve their objective of vaulting China to the forefront of global innovation, a spot that the United States has traditionally enjoyed. The costs instead will be extracted from the gains that American firms would otherwise enjoy in the Chinese market. Contesting this policy should be a principal focus of U.S. commercial diplomacy with China. China's indigenous innovation policies are part of a deep-seated effort by the Chinese leadership to advance the country from its status as a prolific but low-end producer of manufacturers to a position of technological leadership. China is pursuing these policies out of a sense of economic weakness, not strength. This may seem somewhat baffling to an American audience. China often appears to be a paragon of economic accomplishment. Yet the country faces enormous challenges. It remains a relatively poor country with a per capita income in 2009 under $4,000, less than one-tenth that of the United States. China's recent dominance of the global manufacturing scene is neither as secure nor as lucrative as it may seem. Prices and wages are rising in China, and the supply of young workers has begun to dry up. There are newcomers, such as Vietnam and Bangladesh, eager to take China's place. Further, China's impressive export statistics and participation in production of advanced products often conceal a much smaller role when carefully assessed. One recent study of Apple iPods highlighted this. It found that for an iPod with $194 of captured value, $80 went to Apple and $4 went to the manufacturers in China. The indigenous innovation policies themselves are an attempt to spur Chinese innovation by giving Chinese companies privileged access to the substantial Chinese government procurement market. A central and troubling feature of the policies is that they seem intent on extracting foreign technology as the price of access to the Chinese market. There are two broad points I think worth particularly noting about the indigenous innovation policies. One, they're malleable and in a state of flux. And two, the specific measures describing government purchasing preferences are just one aspect of the broader push to stimulate Chinese innovation, largely at foreign expense. The malleability of the policies suggests that this is an area in which diplomatic pressure could have an effect. China, as we've discussed, as others have discussed today, has been steadily revising its policies since these were first laid out in 2009. And in January of this year, as Chairman Royce described, China made commitments delinking government procurement and intellectual property protection. If those commitments were to be taken at face value, they would sound enormously promising. Their true value, of course, is going to depend on the way that they're implemented. One implication of the rapid pace at which the policies are evolving is that the economic impact is particularly difficult to analyze. A central important point to establish, however, is that the Chinese approach to indigenous innovation is unlikely to succeed. There is little history to indicate that cutting-edge technology can emerge from a stultifying, government-dominated approach. Appropriation of other countries' technological advances can facilitate catch-up, but it is distinctly different from crafting a set of policies that will turn a country into a world leader. This means, in turn, that the economic impact on U.S. firms investing in China can be analyzed in a more conventional way. For such firms, China's as-yet ill-defined policies can be thought of as a means of extracting a higher price for participating in the Chinese market. The inadvisability of China's approach to the promotion of innovation provides an opening for diplomatic dialogue. An alternative approach that shunned intellectual property theft, protected innovators of all nationalities, and supported basic research would be beneficial for both China and the West. China's recent concessions may reflect the fruits of a reorientation of U.S. diplomacy away from a fixation on China's undervalued exchange rate toward a set of policies that are arguably both more amenable to negotiation and more important to U.S. economic interests. At summit meetings, countries can only have a single top priority. There is an opportunity cost to pursuing one policy rather than another. To conclude, China is approaching the issue of technological leadership from a position of weakness, not strength. It faces a broad range of concerns about its economic future and is concerned about the economic effects of being relegated to a position of eternal, cheap, low-end manufacture. The United States and China share an interest in seeing China emerge as a prosperous technological innovator, but this emergence should not come about through the expropriation of foreign technology or through skewed market access. China's indigenous innovation policies represent a serious misstep along this path. The policies do not threaten U.S. technological leadership in the long run, but they do threaten to impose substantial costs on U.S. businesses. The willingness of China's leaders to rethink some aspects of this policy is welcome, but a full reorientation is likely to require a sustained and focused prioritization of the issue in U.S. commercial diplomacy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Levy. Ms. Lee?
Thank you very much, Chair Buerkle, Ranking Member Sherman, members of the subcommittee. I appreciate the opportunity to testify this afternoon on behalf of the 12 and a half million members of the AFL-CIO on this important topic of China's indigenous innovation policies. In our view, these policies do pose a threat to the United States of America. Even as the U.S. government has successfully challenged some of these policies, many of the damaging elements of indigenous innovation predated the official launch of the policy, just as some elements will survive the government's decision to step back somewhat in response to the challenge. I think Ms. Laney said before that this is like a game of whack-a-mole, that there are many different ways of achieving some of the goals that have been laid out. And one of the points I wanted to make in general is that the AFL-CIO has been raising the issues about job loss with respect to our unfair and imbalanced trade relationship with China for many years. And what we said many, many years ago was that the manufacturing jobs might move first, but the engineering and the know-how would surely follow. And I believe we are certainly at that place where we need to pay attention to this, as Ms. Laney said, for the future of American industry and the cutting-edge technology that the United States has always enjoyed an advantage in. Our trade relationship with China remains enormously imbalanced and problematic. The Chinese government has violated its international obligations with respect to workers' rights, human rights, currency manipulation, export subsidies, and intellectual property rights. Last year's implementation of Indigenous innovation policy simply extended and deepened this pattern of violations. And each one of these trade violations contribute to the erosion of our industrial base, costing us both our economic and national security. I want to make three big points today. First, that indigenous innovation is a serious problem, but it does not exist in isolation. I think this is consistent with my fellow panelists. It is part of a much broader strategic pattern of behavior by the Chinese government in violation of both U.S. and international trade law. And I would agree with the point that Mr. Rohrabacher made earlier, that it is the responsibility of the U.S. government to enforce our laws more effectively and more aggressively than we have done in the past. The actions by the Chinese government have led to the erosion of the U.S. industrial base, and this poses a direct threat to the nation's economic and national security. And third, the U.S. government needs to take action on trade law violations at the same time as we establish appropriate domestic policies, priorities, and strategies to restore America's industrial leadership. The Chinese government's economic growth strategy relies heavily on export-led growth, primarily to the U.S. market. The elements of the strategy include maintaining the undervalued currency, the industrial policy of targeting favored sectors and technologies through below-market rate loans and subsidies, and protecting domestic markets through overt and covert trade barriers, such as indigenous innovation. The Indigenous Innovation Procurement Policy sets a specific goal of reducing the degree of dependence on technology from other countries from 50% to 30% or less by 2020. The timing coincided with massive public investments at the height of the economic crisis. This action made transparent what other government practices on technology transfer had been achieving by other means. And some of the businesses that had been formerly reticent, and I think we've heard about some of those today, have publicly declared that they're gradually being squeezed out of the Chinese market by government policies that first demand technology transfer in exchange for market access and then favor domestic companies. I think Congressman Sherman mentioned before the enormously imbalanced trade relationship that the United States has with China, with our trade deficit hitting $273 billion in 2010, up 20% from the previous year. I think it's worth noting that fully one-third of our trade imbalance with China is an advanced technology product. So $94 billion, we've had a $94 billion trade deficit with China in advanced technology products. That exceeds our ATP deficit with the world. We had with the rest of the world, taking out China, we had a $12 billion surplus in advanced technology products. But with China, we had a $94 billion deficit. And I think it is worth focusing in on that one number, because what it tells us is that this is not a future problem for us, that one day China may overtake us in advanced technology products. That day is here, and we need to have policies that recognize the urgency of the immediate situation today. Let me conclude by reiterating the point that we have two responsibilities here. One is for the U.S. government to aggressively address the Chinese government's trade violations, and the second for us to establish our own strategic priorities and policies. In particular, a recommitment to investing in our infrastructure, which we have seriously underinvested in, changing our tax policy so that we eliminate the incentives to outsource production, to invest in renewable energy and clean energy so that we can be a leader in that important and growing field, to make sure that we are investing in innovation and in education and workforce policies so that our workers have the skills that they need to compete in the global economy. I thank you for your time, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Ms. Lee. And thank you to all of our panelists today. I yield myself 5 minutes. I know that you all differ with respect to the impact of China's implementation of its medium to long-term plan for the development of science and technology. And I also understand the disagreement regarding what the solutions to the issues raised by China's determination to transition from an economy on manufacturing to an economy determined to expand its technological development. My question is to all three of you. What would a transition from this quiet diplomacy to a more intensified, active commercial diplomacy entail? And do you anticipate that the Chinese government would be more receptive to robust diplomatic overtures? I will start with Dr. Levy.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I think we have been making a bit of this transition. I think it's a question of emphasis. When we are having summit meetings, we have a whole range of dialogues. There's the JCCT, the Strategic and Economic Dialogue, and we have just had a presidential summit. The question is what's put forward as a top priority. And what we've seen is when we make this issue a top priority, we at least see some movement. Is it sufficient movement? Do we declare that we've achieved success and it's done? No, it hasn't gone that far, but we did see some movement. So I guess the early indications are that at that level, there seems to be some progress. And I think it's not entirely clear. People could have different things in mind for a more vigorous policy. If it were something like withdrawing MFN status, I think that would have an entirely counterproductive effect.
Mr. Brooks?
I think there's some value in turning up the heat on China. I think over the years, my experience with China, that strong public messages can have an effect, whether you're talking about human rights or other issues. The challenge is that if everything is important, then nothing is important in a certain sort of way. So I agree with Mr. Levy that you do have to choose what you find to be most important. And there are many, many issues on the table with regards to China. But I don't see any problem at all with raising the visibility of this issue in public discourse by the U.S. government, which has all of the authority and instruments and responsibility for dealing with this, whether you're talking about indigenous innovation or any of the other things. So I think a more vigorous public sentiment expressed by the U.S. government might be helpful, even though private diplomacy certainly does have its place.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks. Ms. Lee?
I'd like to be a little more blunt, and I would say that our current diplomacy with respect to China is muddled, excruciatingly slow, and ineffective by design. And part of that is because it's not just that we have many priorities and none of them get achieved. I think part of it is that there is a serious disconnect between within the business community in the United States of America. You have two different groups, two very distinct groups. One is multinational corporations that may be operating both in the United States and in China. Some of those companies, let's be honest, are actually profiting from the Chinese government's policies, whether it's subsidies or violations of workers' rights and human rights, lack of democracy. Not so much by indigenous innovation, and that's why, for the first time, we actually have the business community rising up in outrage that there are unfair trade practices going on with the country of China. They just noticed it, and they're just getting active. But I think what's really important for the U.S. government is to make sure that we are standing up for domestic producers, those companies, whether they're small and medium-sized companies or large companies that are actually producing in the United States on American soil. Certainly, that's where my members live. My members can't outsource themselves. They need to find a good job here in the United States of America, and they need their own government to stand up for them in a much more consistent and coherent way than we've seen from our own government so far, with respect to currency, subsidies, intellectual property, and workers' rights.
Thank you, Ms. Lee. Mr. Brooks, you mentioned, and just in the short period of time we have left, turning up the heat. What would that entail?
Well, certainly the President of the United States has a bully pulpit to talk about these issues, whether he's traveling in the region and he's in Washington or even in China. So there are opportunities because people do listen to the president, and I think that's one of the ways to do it. Also with the cabinet secretaries, if they're going to go over there, they have an opportunity for blunt talk, and they can talk about these issues here as well, and will be certainly picked up in the region, and also try to get others to speak out. We're not the only ones having this problem, and trying to work in coalition with them to get them to make it clear to the Chinese that these policies aren't acceptable.
Thank you all very much. I now yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from Rhode Island, Mr. Cicilline.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It strikes me from the testimony from all of the witnesses today that it appears as if the principal way that you're recommending we deal with this challenge of indigenous innovation is diplomacy and then commercial diplomacy, which from my perspective seems to have not been very effective. And so I'd like each of the panelists to tell me, are there other strategies that we can engage in that are likely to produce better results than simply raising the public discourse? I think we can do that, but it strikes me we are doing that to some degree. And is it in fact, are we in fact limited simply to engaging in conversation and commercial diplomacy? And coupled with that question is, do we have the ability under the current system to, and the resources devoted to it, to actually know the scope of the problem and to have the information we need to be aggressive in this commercial diplomacy? And I'd ask each of the panelists to respond to that.
Thank you, Congressman. I think there are a number of avenues through which we can pursue this. Diplomacy and sort of conversation about this, I think that's what we're putting, is one of them. There are other things that we can do and that we are doing. I think when there are clear-cut violations of the rules of under the World Trading System, the WTO and the GATT, we can and should and do pursue those. Sometimes those rules are not as comprehensive as we would like. We've already discussed how China is not a signatory to the agreement on government procurement. They are bound by some of the intellectual property restrictions, but we've already had fights at the WTO about just how extensive those obligations are. So I would put forward that one big thing is to strengthen that global trading system, because as Mr. Brooks said, we do have other nations which are facing similar problems, and we strengthen our stance if we're sort of commonly pursuing this. So a stronger WTO system, a successful conclusion to the Doha talks to strengthen this, that would be one element. And we also have aspects of U.S. law, such as Section 337 for intellectual property violations that were raised earlier. So there's a range of these, I think, but trying to influence China's behavior domestically, it is going to be diplomacy, which will be our major tool.
Beyond what Mr. Levy said and others on the panel talking about diplomacy and the WTO issue here, I think that one of the important things is to get our own economic house in order. I think that's critically important. Our economic competitiveness, which China is undermining through these policies, is critically important. When we're not economically competitive, economically powerful, it affects us in many ways besides the well-being of the American people, which is obviously a primary concern. It undermines our international influence. It also affects our military, our hard power, our ability to express do that as well. But I also think we also need to look to expanding free trade beyond China. Well, I'm not necessarily calling it free trade with China, but I mean free trade in general. There are free trade agreements before the Congress that should be looked at. I think that's critically important, providing opportunities for American business to do commerce elsewhere. I also think that we need to, and I'm not an expert in this field, but just as a generalist, is that we need to continue to provide robust opportunities for research and development in this country. What has made America great and an economic power that it is our ability to innovate. And that's why China wants to do exactly that, because they saw what the United States did, as opposed to what the Soviet Union did in becoming a world superpower, besides military power. So I think it's critically important, and I don't know how you get to that, because that's something beyond outside of my lane, something beyond my expertise, but the ability for us to be a great innovator, to create the great new products, I think is critically important. So those are a couple of other things beyond commerce and
thank you.
And WTO.
Thank you. The first thing I would say is that we are talking ourselves into our own economic grave, and time is not on our side in this discourse, that there has been too much talk, there has been too much slowing of the, what we need is more remedies, we need concrete remedies, we need to take our cases to the WTO, we need to take them to a conclusion where we end up actually imposing trade sanctions where we win, and we win most of the cases because China is egregiously in flagrant violation of its WTO obligations on subsidies, on currency, on a whole number of things. I would, for one thing, certainly urge the Congress to go ahead, to move forward with the currency legislation, the Ryan Hunter bill, that has been put forward. I think that is a really important step. It's one big chunk of the economic disadvantage that the United States producers have in the Chinese trade. But I think I would respectfully disagree with Mr. Brooks about the need to do more free trade agreements. I think that's part of the mindset around the free trade agreements is part of what got us into this problem. And I also don't agree that we need to just innovate more. We innovate plenty. You know, we have the technology, we have the education, we have the skills. We're just losing the economic advantage that goes along with that innovation. It's not a question of the United States not being smart enough or technologically advanced enough. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from California, Mr. Orbacher.
Thank you very much. Let me just ask a question of the panel very quickly. We have to be, and then I'll go into the discussion. There are two items, legislative items, that might touch on what we're talking about today. Brad Sherman, who's a member of this subcommittee, has suggested that we pull most favored nation status from China if it continues in its unfair trade practices with the United States. Would you favor that, Mr. Levy?
No, I would not.
Okay, and then Mr. Brooks?
I've not seen the proposal.
Okay,
I have to
Ms. Lee?
I think it's certainly something we should look into.
Okay. There is a patent bill. For 20 years, that there's been a group of us fighting what's been called patent reform. In reality, it's a dramatic, depletion of our patent protection for the American people. And we've had these multinational corporations, about 12 of them, we call them the Dirty Dozen, who make who basically are interested in manufacturing overseas and manufacturing in China in particular. But they have been trying to weaken the patent system in our country, saying that we need to harmonize it with the rest of the world. Well, the rest of the world, of course, has very weak patent protection. The United States has very strong patent protection. There is a new bill working its way through Congress. Those of us who are for strong intellectual property protection are against this bill. Mr. Levy, is your organization for, or have they taken a stand? Are you for or against this patent so-called reform?
AEI doesn't take stands as an institution, and I'm afraid I don't know enough about that particular bill to give an intelligent comment.
Okay, Mr. Brooks?
I'm in the same situation.
Okay, I would suggest that the two of you have your organizations look at this legislation. It is put out by the same people who've been trying to destroy the patent system for 20 years, and we could use your opinion on it. Ms. Lee, what's about the AFL-CIO?
No, I haven't been following that bill closely, so I can get you an answer,
well,
but I don't
me,
have
let me suggest that you do so. It's very important. Yeah, we have spent a lot of money. We spend lots of money on innovation. We spend lots of money on research, and a lot of it ends up in the hands of our competitor. That's a travesty. That's a travesty. We give a lot of these companies who end up going over to China to do manufacturing, a lot of them have been the recipient of major R&D grants by the United States government. This is ridiculous. This is us paying for to work against the well-being of our own working people. I would suggest that we've got some really major issues at hand here. Let me ask about the market. You mentioned, Mr. Brooks, free trade. Now, I believe I'm a free trader, just to let you know, and Ms. Lee, I hate to tell you that, but I'm a free trader, but I don't see how you can have free trade unless the people who are trading are both free. I say I'm for free trade between free people. How can you have free trade, Mr. Brooks, if the other side of the equation is controlled trade? So it's only one free trade system, and then it leaves it up to being manipulated by the gangsters and the thugs who run these other countries. It's not really free trade, is it, if you don't have freedom on both sides of the equation?
I don't dispute that.
Okay, well, that's what's been happening to our relationship with communist China for the last 40 years. They have used market access and subsidies, intellectual property theft and currency manipulation in order to control what's going on over there. While we have given them access to our markets, tried to be as make sure that we're even-handed in terms of our currencies and our subsidies and our own regulation of our own businesses here. But instead, that type of, let me just note, this type of sincerity, I'm sure, is deeply appreciated by the goons who control the power in Beijing. Those people look at us like we're fools. And our people are paying a big price, and there's a lot of CEOs in this country who are going along with it because they can make a quick profit. A quick profit in China and put themselves, put a big bonus in their pocket, and then leave the scene by the time the real economic repercussions are felt from transferring all over the R&D and transferring over the investment and the machinery and the technology that we've developed in the United States. This is an issue that really needs a close look. I understand where Ms. Lee is coming from. I would hope that my friends on the conservative side of this spectrum start looking and realizing that we have to represent the interests of the people of the United States of America. And just spouting off free trade when you're allowing it to be manipulated on the other side by gangsters is a great disservice to our country. So with that, thank you very much, Madam
Thank Chair. You, Mr. Rohrabacher. I now yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from California, the ranking member, Mr. Sherman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do want to mention a word or two about the bill I'll be reintroducing.
Which I mentioned before you came in, and I support, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, because, Madam Chair, I've been here for a while. This is not the first gripe session I've been to about China. I've been to these for 15 years, and one option you'll have and the other new members of Congress will have is to join for another 15 years of gripe sessions. You'll also have the joy of the sign-on letters, where you can send letters to the Chinese embassy and sign your name. And if you think that accomplishes something, more power to you. But the other approach is for us to force a crisis in this relationship, because I think we already have a crisis for the United States. 6 months, end MFN for China, and tell the Chinese that if they want to export $400 billion worth of goods to the United States, they're going to have to import $400 billion of goods from the United States. A balanced trade agreement with China will hopefully be the result, but we're certainly not going to get such an agreement from them as long as they have free access to the U.S. market under the conditions partially described by today's hearings. Now, it's unfortunate that our witness from the ITC has left. I'm not seeing any senior staff from ITC here unless they identify themselves for the record. So I will make sure that our first witness gets the transcript of the second half of the hearing, and I would hope that the executive branch would view congressional hearings not as a burden but as an opportunity for learning. One of the things we learned from the ITC was that they do surveys of employers to see if we have any problems. Ms. Lee, they ever survey organizations that represent workers?
Not that I know of.
Wouldn't you be among the organizations that represent workers that they would typically? Can you think of a larger organization than the one you represent that represents workers?
No.
And as we've seen, there are at least some businesses who think that they can enjoy a profit by offshoring, maybe just a short-term profit. So we ought to have an ITC that is worker-oriented, not just company-oriented. Ms. Lee, what would you think of the ITC no longer being an independent organization, but instead being part of the Department of Labor?
I think it would certainly be a huge improvement if the ITC did take its job seriously as looking at the impact on workers, not just on businesses and the profitability of businesses, but that they took seriously the how working people might be impacted by different changes in trade policy. And of course, you mentioned earlier that their economic modeling with respect to the job impact of trade agreements has been notoriously inaccurate over many years, and yet it's still used as though those numbers are gospel. And so, you know,
they were within a couple $1 trillion over the last decade, and you criticize them. Are you always that tough? Let me move on to another question, Ms. Lee. Does not regularly associate organized labor with intellectual property concerns, perhaps because the creators of intellectual property are, for the most part, not unionized. Can you explain why IP protection, especially combating theft and compelled transfer of American IP by the Chinese, is a significant concern for the AFL-CIO?
I'd be delighted to. And first of all, we do represent a lot of both performers and writers and other people who make a living from intellectual property rights, musicians and actors and so on. And we often hear from those unions that they are very much in favor of strengthening the intellectual property rights protections that we have overseas. They lose billions and billions of dollars worth of revenues. Some of that is revenues to the performers themselves through the violations of intellectual property rights. In the music industry, for example, the Chinese music market is worth around $100 million, but it should be more than $1 billion. So that's $900 million worth of revenues that is lost to both American musicians and also companies because of internet theft and because of other physical theft of the intellectual property rights. So there certainly are a lot of jobs, and there is income associated with the violation of intellectual property rights. That's also true, I think, you know, we talked about, Mr. Rohrabacher used the example of the carts, you know, when the design of the carts is stolen and moved to China. Those 100 workers lost their jobs immediately. His friend, you know, at least was able to keep the ownership and do a joint venture for several years before he was edged out of the company, but those 150 workers or so lost their jobs immediately.
I'm going to ask unanimous consent to be able to ask one more question.
Without objection.
This Korea Free Trade Agreement, it allows goods to be 65% made in China. For certain classes of goods, that percentage is different, but 65% is what applies to auto, ships, electronics, boilers, aluminum, iron, steel. And then those goods can go to South Korea, where Chinese guest workers living in barracks can do the other 35% of the work. Do you think that American workers will be at a disadvantage if they have to compete against goods that are made exclusively with Chinese labor, and instead of most favored nation status, we have free trade agreement treatment of those goods? And do you think it's fair that goods that are 100% Chinese labor can come into the United States with a free trade agreement totally duty-free, while China will have duties on all our goods? In other words, we'd have a one-way free trade agreement with China.
Well, we are always in favor of stronger rules of origin because we think that if we're going to negotiate a trade agreement with a country, the benefits should go to the country that makes the concessions, whether it's on intellectual property rights or market access or workers' rights or environmental protections. And so we were very concerned about the Korea FTA and the relatively weak rule of origin there that allows quite a large quantity of the final product to be assembled outside of South Korea. It could be in China, as you could be in North Korea, it could be other places, and that is very troubling to us. It's not good for Korean workers, it's not good for U.S. workers. We have been in contact with our Korean counterparts, and they're also very concerned that the benefits of the agreement will not necessarily go to the two countries that have signed
Thank you for mentioning the tremendous benefits that North Korea will get under this agreement, which I haven't mentioned up until now, because those are the subject in part of our hearing tomorrow.
Thank you, Mr. Sherman. Let me begin by saying thank you to our panelists and for taking time out of your busy schedules to come here today and testify. We appreciate that very much. Without objection, your full testimonies will be entered and made part of the record, and members will have 5 days to add any questions or opening statements to the record. The subcommittee hearing is adjourned.